You know what you're listening to? You're listening to the Deen Team, bringing the light of Islam right into your hearts.
Follow us on Facebook at the Deen Team Sydney radio program and subscribe to our YouTube channel, Deen Team Sydney.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Our listeners, welcome to another episode of the Teen Team. With you today, your brother in Islam, Malaz, Majani, and I've got Mazin with me. And today we have a very, very special guest with us in the studio. We have with us today Imam Siraj Wahhaj, all the way from Masjid al-Taqwa, from Brooklyn,
yes,
New York. Welcome to the show, Imam.
Thank you so much. I'm very honored to be here.
And it's an absolute pleasure to have you with us on the show today.
May Allah bless this station. You know, anytime we have any media, radio, television, for Muslims, especially you know in non-Muslim countries, it's always very pleasurable for me to just to see it, to listen to it, and especially to participate in it. That's alhamdulillah, it's a dream come true.
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. It's an absolute pleasure to have you on the program, and Mazin, I mean, I'm very excited having you know Imam Siraj with us on the radio. How do you feel about this today?
I'm actually very excited myself. It's an honor to have you with us, Imam. And you know, one of the things you know I've really looked forward to, and thank you for sharing your time with us. I know you're very, very busy, and you know you're here for only a very short time. Is to get some insight from you, Imam, about your experiences, particularly as a Muslim in the West, and the work that you've done or that you've been involved in over time. You know, so one of the first sort of things that came to our mind was, you know, an identity question about, you know, Muslim, for instance, you know, in Australia, Muslim or Australian, you know, and this is, you know, sometimes gets brought, you know, depending on what happens out in the community.
It is a very good question. And when you look at myself, I have multi-identities and, you know, and I like to acknowledge all of them. For instance, I could say, Ana Aswad. I'm black. I'm black, you know, or I could say Ana Afrikiyun. My ancestors are from Africa, and that would be a good distinction. But you can also say Ana Amerikiyun, because actually I'm an American, because I was born in America. But there's another identity, Ana Muslim. I'm a Muslim. And for me, the most crucial identity is a Muslim, and I'll tell you why. Because, you know, I chose to be a Muslim. That was my decision when I was 19 years old in America. I had been a Christian, and one of the wonderful things about our country in America and of course this country is the freedom of religion. It's crucial, and you don't have that in every nation. So I'm very thankful to be in a nation where I can choose to be a Muslim. And if I celebrate the fact that I can become a Muslim, then I celebrate the fact that you can decide to be not to be a Muslim. Or to be an atheist if you want to be. So it was my choice at 19 years old to become a Muslim. And why I say that's the most important thing for me is because I really cherish the thought of going to the hereafter, to go into paradise, to go into the heaven, to go to what's called Al-Jannah. I want to go there, but there's not one person in Al-Jannah because they're black. There are no people in paradise because they're Americans, Australians, or Africans, or Arabs, or men, or women. We go to Jannah by Allah's grace because we practice. We're Muslim. We submit to Allah the Almighty. That's why it's important for me. My first and most important identity is as Muslim. The other thing is I don't shy away from the fact that I'm American. I'm an American citizen. Fareed Zachariah, he works with CNN News, very, very famous, very well known, but he's a Muslim. And he wrote an article, a Muslim by choice, I'm sorry, American by choice. So he wasn't born as an American, he became an American citizen. But even though I'm American by birth, I'm smart enough to know that if I don't want to be in America, I could leave. And I want to be in America. America is my country, it's my home. I love it. So when people talk about the West, you can't exclude the Muslims because I am the West. And when you look at the Muslims, one-third of the Muslim Ummah is in non-Muslim countries. And where are they? primarily in the West. You know, you find them in America, you find them in Germany, you find them in Spain, in France, and large numbers in different parts of the globe. Muslims ought not have a difficult time reconciling with being, for instance, a Muslim and an American, a Muslim or an Australian, a Muslim or a German. It's always my argument that the best Americans, in my opinion, are Muslims who practice their faith. If we practice our faith the way we're supposed to be, we'll make a great contribution to whatever country we're in. And I think it's the height of treachery to be in a country that you don't like. If you've made a decision that you don't like your country for whatever reason, don't tear it down. Either you have two choices. You fix it, make it better, like black people did, African Americans who fought for their civil rights in America in the 50s and the 60s and the 70s, like people like Martin Luther King Jr. and Malcolm X and others who fought to make America a better place, not just for black people, but for other people. So you fix it up as Muslims. Are there some things that I don't like about my country? It's crazy for us to think that we accept everything in every country. But what we do, we fight, we try to make it better, bring more justice and freedom and all of those kinds of things. And the other thing, if you don't like it, then go to a country that you feel meets your ideal and you want to live in that country. So I don't have a problem reconciling with being an American and reconciling with being a Muslim. I have all of these identities, and alhamdulillah, that's our choice.
Alhamdulillah, mashallah. Imam Siraj Wahhaj, I really want to tap into your experience. I mean, you have a lot of experience within Dawah, within the West. And this is something that we would like to sort of tap into and learn and get some advice from. But what do you think the responsibility of a Muslim da'i in the West is?
You know, the first thing, just remind Muslims about who we are and what our responsibility is. And I think you have to be right to know that our responsibility is to be a Muslim. To live according to the dictates of Allah, what He teaches us, how to worship Him, and things like that. So our first responsibility is toward ourselves, our families, to make sure that our wives, our children, can be the very best Muslims they can, to go to the masjid. I've been blessed with 9 children, and all of them,
mashallah,
Allah blessed me to send every one of them to Muslim full-time school. So I'm very happy about that. And then after having done that, then our responsibility is toward the country that we live in. One of the things that Muslims believe that Allah taught His Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him, that every prophet that ever came to their particular people. With qala Musa liqaumihi, when Moses said to his people, with qala Isa ibn Maryam, ya bani Israel, inni rasulullah alaikum. And so when Moses said, oh my people, he was referring to the children of Israel. When Jesus said, oh my children, oh my people, I am the messenger of Allah to you, Jesus was sent to the children of Israel. But according to the Quran, that Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him, wasn't sent to a particular people, but he was sent to all mankind. Qul ya ayyuhan nas inni rasulullah alaykum jamia. Allah says, say this, Muhammad, say this to the people, oh my mankind, I am the messenger of Allah to all of you. So therefore, our responsibility, if you think about, you can make a good argument. Now, you have to think about it for a while. You may want to attack me if you don't think about it, but you got to think about it for a while, right?
Okay.
You can make a good argument that the Quran came not to the Muslims and for the Muslims, but the Quran came for mankind. The reason I said that is that Muhammad, when he first came, peace and blessing be upon him, he was the only one. And he was the first one. I remember reading in Sahih Bukhari about Prophet Abraham, peace and blessing be upon him, a conversation that he had with his wife Sarah, which is a very interesting conversation, and I think about it often. Ya Sarah, laysa ala wajhi adhi mu'min gadi wa gadiki. Oh Sarah, there's not one believer on the face of the earth other than you and me. When I think about Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessing be upon him, I think about a man coming, receiving revelation, and now he begins to go take his message to the world. Who does he begin with? He begins with his wife Khadija, radiallahu anha. So you think about his mission wasn't just for himself. His mission was to save mankind, all of mankind. When he thinks about his work, he's thinking about everyone. So when you think about beginning with that one man 1400 years ago, peace and blessing be upon him, look how it spread, first kind of slowly, but he never ever gave up the work of da'wah, or calling people to Islam. That was his primary work. And if you look about it, you think about that golden generation, that first generation of Muslims that represented the foundation of where we are today. I always like to say, someone asked the question, how long will the building stand? Answers, how strong is the foundation? The foundation 1400 years ago was so strong. You think about those Muslims at that particular time. خَرُ أُمَّتِي قَارِنِي ثُمَّ لَدِينَ يُنُونُهُمْ ثُمَّ لَدِينَ يُنُونُهُمْ The best of my ummah is my generation. And then the generation that follows it. So you saw that great generation built so that all over the world now we have Muslims. Some 1,600,000,000 Muslims around the world began with one. Our work of da'wah is critical. I am disappointed tremendously in any Muslim country that doesn't devote time, resources, money toward talking to non-Muslims. I think one of the issues is that we continue to look at non-Muslims as the enemy, the other. It's not our job. Even if they hate us, our responsibility is to teach the message. And there's two ways to do that, two primary ways. And the major one to me, which is the most important, is to live the very best example that we can as a Muslim. That we should not cheat or deceive anyone, not whether they're Muslim or non-Muslim. In fact, it is our good character that makes people say, you know what, I don't know all about Islam, I didn't read the Quran, I didn't read the sayings of Prophet Muhammad, I didn't do any of that, but I have a Muslim neighbor, he's the most beautiful person I've ever seen in my life. You know, he's helped me. I remember the times when my family needed someone, my neighbor, my Muslim neighbor's right there. I have a Muslim merchant. I buy products from them, and they never cheat me. I have a Muslim doctor that really cares about me. He's really professional. I have a Muslim professor. He's my best professor ever. When we do those things, that itself is a da'wah. And then there are people who specialize in giving lectures, going to colleges and universities and even churches and organizations, and having talks to non-Muslims. We should always have that. I think that we should be careful about debates. I have I hesitate about some debates because a lot of them, they create hostility. So we should have dialogues rather than debates, in my opinion. But if it's done in a tasteful way, debates can be useful. But again, the very idea, I think all Muslims should be taught, every Muslim should be taught about the value of inviting people to Islam. I mean, you don't have to go up to strangers and say, hey, you want to know about Islam? No, I don't think we should do that, but there are ways we can do it. And every way, almost every day, Allah gives you some way in a very easy, natural way to give da'wah, to talk to someone about Islam. On the job is one of the easiest. I remember years ago, I was working at a mental health clinic. My coworkers would like ask me questions. You don't want nothing to drink today? No, I can't drink today because I'm fasting. What you mean you're fasting? Well, this is the month of Ramadan. This is the month in which Muslims fast. They're fascinated with that. When they see me, I let them know, oh yeah, by the way, I'm going to make prayer. I'll be 5 minutes, this is time for our prayer. You make prayer like five times a day. And they're looking at you practicing your religion. I'll never forget this. One day, I was making prayer in one of the offices where I worked. This is 600-700 years ago, right? I was in my office, right? Making prayer. And while I was praying, I heard the phone ring. And I heard one of the co-workers, pick up the phone. They're not Muslims, right? And they said, oh yeah, he's making salat. Wow. And I said, wow. So, they know. And then the women, you teach them. Sometimes they want to shake your hand. Now you got to make a decision. And I thought on my job that it was important to let the women know that just like Orthodox Jews, Muslims think it's not respectable to shake the hands of women other than their wives and their daughters and their mothers and things like that. So we got a chance to do a lot of dawah. And then once in a while, they're going to ask you questions about your faith. If they see you enough and you're practicing it, you're not hiding your faith. I think some Muslims, one of the tragedies is that they hide their faith. They don't want people to know that they're Muslim, and they try to just go along the business without letting them know. But I think you should let them know in a very good way that, yes, I'm a Muslim, and this is what Muslims do.
Well, it seems like everyone has their role to play when it comes to dawah out in the community.
Everyone.
But I want to ask you a specific question. Does a Muslim need to have knowledge to give dawah, or is this something that, where do you draw the line?
It's a great question. The first thing, if you think about it, the greatest da'i ever, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in my opinion, right? He receives a revelation, a few words, Iqra, a few words. And he doesn't wait until he becomes Hafiz of Quran before he starts teaching. He doesn't wait until he gets all of this wisdom to start teaching. Immediately, he goes to his wife Khadija, and she becomes Muslim. His best friend Abu Bakr, radiallahu anhu, he becomes Muslim. Ali, his cousin, becomes Muslim. And those first few people became Muslim. They didn't become Muslim because of the awesomeness of the message of Islam, but by the conviction of a man and that man's character, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the Prophet kind of, played a, I want to say, trick on his tribe. When Allah gave him the commandment to go out and warn his tribes, and he called all his tribesmen together. And this is the trick. This is kind of, this is a divine halal trick. He said, what if I told you that there was an army coming to attack you? Would you believe me? They said, yeah, we believe you. Of course. You're trustworthy, And he said, well, I bear witness that there's no God but Allah. I'm a warner from Allah. So now they're caught in this trick because they said you're trustworthy, we believe you, and why wouldn't you believe me now when I'm telling you this? So that goes to the issue about credibility. One of the most important characteristics of a da'i, in my opinion, of a da'i is credibility, is character, is credibility. Because if they don't believe you, if they see you as a liar, and it's very difficult for them to separate your character from what you were saying. And this is why I go back to the point about a da'i. It's so important that the Muslims show the true character of what Islam is. I asked myself the question that if I didn't know about Islam, and this is 2013, if I didn't know about Islam, I hadn't read about it, and I see what's going on in the Muslim world, even the contradictions, even in non-Muslim countries, Muslims in non-Muslim countries, what would make me, if I didn't read the books, what would make me become a Muslim? It would be very difficult for me, as an outsider, to become a Muslim. And I'm seeing all this chaos, especially from reading the media, and especially if you go to even websites and stuff like that. So many negative things said about Islam. That's one issue. But then the bad things coming from the Muslims is another thing. So when you go to the courts in New York City, and when you see all of these Muslims, convicted of crimes, go to the prisons, you see Muslims who didn't convert in prison, which a lot of them did, but those who were Muslims and didn't wind up going to prison, doing the same thing everyone else is doing. So the people say, what's the sense? You're Muslim, but you Muslims kill. Just like the other people kill, they commit crime, they sell drugs like other people sell drugs, and you guys, you're all the same. So the da'i has to be, I can't necessarily fix the other guy, but I can at least fix myself and try to make myself a good character, inshallah. And that's part of the importance of da'wah. The second thing is, which is intriguing about your question, is that knowing your faith is important. And because when you look at the Quran, there are a lot of verses that's called the fitna amra, which is commandments. And it's interesting. There's one word in particular that's really intriguing to me. The word qala, he said, qalat, she said, and kutu, I said. But the thing that intrigues me is kul, say, and it's singular. Masculine. So Allah is speaking to one man. in most of those verses, Allah is speaking to Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him. And I counted just about 365 times that that word is used in the Quran. That means Prophet Muhammad ain't making up nothing. Just say this. Say that. Say this. Say this. Qul huwa Allahu ahad. Say that. Say this. Say that. Say that. And I said, wow, Allah has given him a script. And many of us, we go off script. And that's the problem. The problem isn't the script. The problem is that we go off script because we're not listening to Allah the Almighty. So we have that. So not only do we know what Allah told the Prophet to say, then every once in a while Allah throws us a bone. He says, Kulu, you all say this.
SubhanAllah, Sheikh. Imam, it's, you know, one of the things that we appreciate in having you around is that you've been on that journey. Probably, you know, the community in America is, in terms of age and experience and history is probably a little bit more advanced than, for instance, in Australia. So with that comes obviously experiences that you guys have had over there in the States, which we may or may not have experienced yet. You know, from your experiences, though, you know, what are the challenges that, you know, you and your organization, for instance, that have had to deal with that, you know, need that focus and that attention?
Yeah, first of all, I'm going to agree with you on something that you said that's critical, that's about experience. Yeah. Muawiyah said, La hakima ila dhul tajriba. There's no real wisdom without experience. And I do agree that the thing about experience that's good is that it gives you an opportunity. So you learn not only from your experience the good of it, but even the bad of it.
Yep.
And you learn what doesn't work.
Yep.
So Allah has blessed us with a tremendous amount of experience. I think one of our great challenges right now is the onslaught of all of the anti-Islam attacks.
Yeah.
If people would just let us be to do our work as da'i, the work would be pretty easy. People come to Islam. We have such contact with non-Muslims, which is critical, by the way. We shouldn't isolate ourselves. And even though my nine children, all of them went to a Muslim school, but that's not the reality in America. The reality is that less than 5% of Muslim children go to Muslim full-time schools. That means 95% or more go to non-Muslim schools. They go to public schools or private non-Muslim schools, right? Take New York City, for instance. According to a report by Columbia University, 10 to 12% of the total school population, public school population in New York City, are Muslims. And by the way, just for a record, the city council of New York City, by the prompting of the Muslims, introduced a bill that would make the public school Muslim two holidays, the Eid, would make it a holiday for New York City to such a degree that when the 2 days of Eid come, that all the schools would be closed. It passed in city council by something like 122 to 1. So it passed, but we had one problem. In order for it to become law, the mayor had to sign it, and the mayor refused to sign. So right now it's sitting there, and from what we understand, this is the last term for the mayor, so he can't run for office again. But those who are running for office, they have come to see us, and all of them said they will sign it. So look soon that it would be law in New York City that whenever the Eid came by, all the schools would be closed, which is amazing. The point that I'm making about that is that our children have an opportunity to interact with non-Muslim children. If they're in a Muslim school, which is good, I recommend it. Go to a Muslim school, learn about Islam, I recommend that. But the reality is every Muslim child won't go to a Muslim school. So where are they? They're in the public school. What's going to happen? Either they're going to be consumed by the non-Muslims in their religion, because the Prophet did say, "Amar al-Din khalili fayandur ahadukum ayyukhalil." A person will follow the religion of a very close companion. Therefore, let every one of you be very careful whom you shall choose as a friend. So, one of the difficulties is that when the Muslim children are around non-Muslims, they can pick up some of the bad habits. On the one hand, but on the other hand, Muslims can do Dawah in their schools, and because of the interaction. One of the places, if you ask some of the Muslim personalities, those who converted from Christianity to Islam, many of them converted, like myself, I was 19 years old. If you ask Hamza Yusuf, Imam Zaid Shakir, Suhaib Webb, all of them around that age, when we were in college, a great opportunity for dawah. College students are wide open. So when you got Muslims going to college campuses, you have two things. You have, for instance, the Muslims who go to college, and then you have the MSA, Muslim Student Associations, on college campuses. They have a lot of dawah has been done by these organizations. We have organizations like in my masjid, we have a group specifically for dawah. They go out all the time. They always work in 100% for dawah. So we have a lot of those organizations that works. One year, I'll never forget this. Our community, the brothers, we went out and we had these pamphlets. Who was Muhammad? And we went out to the projects in Brooklyn, and we gave over 100,000 pamphlets about who was Muhammad. And everywhere we went, we would walk in the streets, and people said, give me one. And we saw the people reading it all over, everyone. And that helped. As a result of that, because on the pamphlet, it had our address, it had our phone number, people called us, people came to the masjid. Even we were actually knocking on people's doors, and every once in a while we would knock on the door, and it was Muslims who lived there who hadn't really been practicing, and some of them started practicing again. So, I think the problem always with us, I always say this, isn't the kafir, isn't how to give dawah, but having the heart to want to do dawah, to want to share this great message with the masses of the people. If you do that, if you have the heart for dawah, you start doing it. Yeah, you'll see it. You'll start doing it. And I think once you do it, you'll love it. The taste of it. And by the way, let me tell you where I got a lot of my experience from the Nation of Islam. The people in the Nation of Islam, say what you want to say about the Aqidah. Say, well, they don't have the right Aqidah. You would be right. They don't really have the right practice of Islam. You would be right. But you can't deny their spirit of dawah. They are the best, one of some of the best da'in in the world. I was part of that. And we had a mandate. We couldn't come to the temple unless we had to bring somebody to the temple, bring a guest to the temple. I think we need more of that in the Muslim Ummah.
SubhanAllah. Imam, you mentioned that you've got 9 children.
Yes.
Inshallah. I want to ask you about how, I mean, within the household, I mean, you've spoken about being out on the job site, being in the university or the campus. What about within the home? What's your advice for raising young da'is within the home?
Not easy. I have, of my 9 children, I can say 6 of them are practicing. And 3 of them are shaky. You know, and the reason I say that publicly, because I want to be honest, and I want people to realize that one of the struggles of us is not only giving dawah, but making sure our own families, you know, stay intact. This is not uncommon. You can be the child of a prophet and not believe. You see, and every Muslim masjid, every Muslim organization have 2 doors. They have the front door by which people come in and they become Muslims. I came to that door. Sheikh Abdul Hakim Quick came to that door. Sheikh Bilal Phillips came to that door. Hamza Yusuf, all of those converts that came to that front door. But they also have a back door by which Muslims leave the faith. Our job is open wide the front door and close that back door as much as we can. And the thing about Islam that makes it so beautiful, we have a mandate in our religion that we cannot force people to believe. For years, I would always tell my children, I said, you want to be Muslim? I said, you're born to parents who are Muslim, but do you want to be Muslim? Every once in a while, we gather together and I would ask them. So when they got older, again, some of them made their choice. They don't say, I'm not a Muslim. But the practice isn't always there. So the big challenge is how do you keep your children into the faith? One of the things that I did is send them to Muslim school. I thought that made a difference. But even then, when you graduate from the Muslim school and then you go on, because we had in New York City, though we had a lot of Muslim schools, we have like 35 full-time Muslim schools in New York City, but we're the Muslim colleges. So, you know, so our daughters and sons had to wind up going to non-Muslim colleges, and so that's a challenge. So, I forgot your question.
Question is, I mean, how do you, within the household, what's your advice for listeners out there in terms of bringing up young children? I mean, is it about really setting an environment, an Islamic environment? Is it about switching the TV off more often? What's your advice?
It's all of them. Mm-hmm. It's all of them, you know, because you can only supervise them to a certain time, right? We try to supervise them. That's part of it. But the other part is to, you know, it's encouraging them the best way we can to control the TV the best way we can. I think the biggest key is when they're younger, and it's easier to mesh them when they're very, very young. But when they get older, then that's going to be the very difficult time, because they're not around you all the time. Even if you put a block on the TV, they unblock it. You know, a block on the computer, they unblock it. They're more sophisticated. And maybe not you two brothers, but most of them are more sophisticated than us, and they run rings around us in terms of the computers and internet and stuff like that. So it's just being conscious as much as you can. I took my youngsters when they were young. I used to take them to Muslim camps, for instance. Everything that you can do, and then at the end of the day. You're left with this ayah, إِنَّ قَالَ تَحْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتَ وَلَكِنَ اللَّهِ يَحْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. You can't guide those whom you love, but Allah guides to the straight path whomever He pleases. And the other thing I would say, I think is critical, that a lot of our children, they experiment, they go, they leave the deen, they come back sometimes. So I think that it's important that we keep the door open. If they, you know, go to a stage where they want to experiment with the dunya, whatever it is, they're enthralled by the dunya, but always keep the door open and always have them always willing to bring them back.
It's the mercy that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught us to deal with people. I know I sort of picked up from what you were saying, Imam, about, you know, I guess if you want to categorize as two types of dawah, really, there's the transitionary, what they call the transitionary dawah, where you introduce it gradually. Especially, I think it's applicable to us as Muslims in the West, in terms of how we are with non-Muslims. So I think, you know, that's very important.
Yeah, I think, you know, a da'i can't be in a hurry and think that, man, I gave a dynamite speech, man, they're all going to jump up and become Muslims. That's not the reality of how people change. People usually change gradually. Every once in a while, someone, I think they're at a point in their lives where they're actually looking for something. And, you know, that's the person that goes to the masjid and really hears a lecture, and something touches him and he stands up. And he takes shahada. I mean, we go in places, 7, 8, 9, 10 people take shahada. But that isn't, you know, that isn't the norm. And by the way, I want to say something about that. I think it's critical. Sometimes people get really excited and they take shahada, they become Muslim. Everybody jump up, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. And the sisters are crying and the brothers are crying. And we're hugging them. And then you watch 10 minutes later, they're just standing there by themselves. Like, okay, what do I do now? So our community has a major effort that when they take shahada, we don't leave them alone. We take them and we bring them into a class for 10 weeks. We follow them, we track them. Someone has responsibility to talk to them, you know, to remind them, to bring them out and things like that. Because we find out that a lot of times people come, they take shahada, and that's it. They're excited. So every once in a while, someone will come and they'll take shahada at that moment, and like they're really excited because they're looking for something. But that isn't the norm. The norm is that people, they hear something, then they read something, and they'll see something, and all of that adds together. Then before you know it, you have actually groomed that person and the seed has been planted, and everywhere you go, someone is adding to the seed and the growth, and then you know, or then ultimately then you have classes and programs, and you bring them to programs. Our masjid, every year we have an open house. Every year, and we tell them, the Muslims, to bring their friends and their family members, and we get shahadas every year. Every year. So it's a major effort. It's a major da'wah effort that our masjid do. In fact, it's so successful, we think about doing twice a year, and even quarterly. But I think that if more Muslims do that, have open houses, let the non-Muslims come into the because the masjid is such a mysterious place. What y'all doing there? What's going on in there? You know. So and we let them know. Bring them in. We have had police and other agencies come in to the masjid. And by the way, I'm trying to remember, you know, the New York City police force is the largest perhaps in the world, certainly in the United States. And New York City, if I'm not mistaken, is about 1,000 Muslim police officers.
Sure.
Huge, huge. So when you start seeing Muslims involved in the society, it is those Muslims in that society that have effects on people. There's a brother there, I know, a doctor. Every year he brings me some program in his hospital. You know, he does it during Ramadan, and he brings his coworkers. These are doctors. Now he has more effect on the doctors than me, right? Because he's a doctor. They look at him, oh, he's like me. He's a professional like me. He's a doctor just like me. He's a cardiologist just like me. He's a brain surgeon just like me. So he's done the work. And then they bring Imam Siraj. I come there and I give them a talk. And before you know it, we have some other more professionals who in fact come into the fold of Islam.
MashaAllah. Imam,
everywhere that, you know, we have a young brother in a place called Cleveland. You know, some people think Cleveland is a city in the United States. They think like another country, right? But we got a young brother there, Muslim brother named Bashir Jones. He's running for city council. And some people think that this Muslim, Bashir Jones, one day will be the mayor of Cleveland. And Cleveland is a place, by the way, where LeBron James played. And this brother, Bashir Jones, this guy who's going to run for city council, he's probably going to win and become mayor one day, probably going to win and become a congressman one day, probably going to win. He probably can bring LeBron James from Miami back to Cleveland. That's how bad he is. And then not only that, not only bring LeBron James back to Cleveland, he probably give him a shahada. That's how bad he is.
Mashallah. Imam Siraj Wahhaj, it's been an absolute pleasure having you with us on the show.
SubhanAllah. Imam, I actually wish that we didn't have to finish, but unfortunately our time's come to an end. It's been an absolute pleasure having you on the show, and we do wish you, you know, all the best in your travels, and inshallah that we have you back.
Yes.
You know, on our shores and yes, amongst us, inshallah.
Absolutely. But guess what? We have such technology that I don't have to come over here all the way to Australia, 9,000 miles. You can actually do a program in my office in New York City.
Inshallah. But your presence is most welcome.
Thank you so much, brother. I really enjoyed myself. I thank you, brothers. You're wonderful host. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless you. And just for the record, I want you to know that for years, not just now, not because you're in front of me, brothers who know me will tell you that when I go places around the world, I always talk about my love for Australia. When you come to the airport, there's a sign there, I believe it, that it's true, that if you come to Australia, you may not want to go back home. and sometimes I feel that way. I've been on tours to Australia. I love it. I think the people are extraordinary. I think the Muslims are wonderful. And I enjoy being here, despite the long, long, long trip. But it's an absolute pleasure. So I'm going to thank you, brothers, for having me on the radio program. And I want to give salams to all of the Muslims in Australia. And I know Ramadan is, by the time they hear this message, I think we'll be in Ramadan. So I wish them a very, very great Ramadan. I hope that this is the best Ramadan for them ever in their lives. Mm-hmm. That they'll get everything that they can, all the gifts that Allah has thrown to us on this sacred month of Ramadan. I pray that they would get it, inshallah, and serve them in this life as well as the hereafter.
Imam Siraj Wahhaj, Jazakallah Khair for being on our show today. Our dear listeners, we've come to the end of our show. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Until next time, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Follow us on Facebook at the Deen Team Sydney radio program and subscribe to our YouTube channel, Deen Team Sydney.